السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اللهم تسليما كثيرا. معاذ بن جبل رضي الله عنه وأرضاه. I have some thoughts during the week while reflecting on the life of Mu'ad, completing what we started last week. And I feel that although Mu'ad radiallahu anhu arda accepted Islam early in his age, but late in the after the prophethood started. Early in his age, he was 18 years old, as we said last time. But it was the year 13. After the starting of the Risala and the prophethood, it was in the Bayat Aqaba Thaniya. Bayat Al-Aqaba Thaniya is in the year 13. Bayat Al-Aqaba Al-Ula, which is in Hajj of the year 13. Bayat Al-Aqaba Al-Ula is the Hajj of the year 12. And he came in the second year with the people of Medina in the 13th, which was just a few months before the Hijrah. The Hijrah was in Safar, 27th of Safar of the year 14 after the Ba'tha. Which is at the beginning of the year 14. So Mu'az accepted Islam late 13 years after, almost 13 years after the starting of the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are many people of the Sahaba who preceded him before that. 13 years of actions, he missed all of his actions out of hand. All the people of Medina missed all of that. The people of Medina accepted Islam. The first one to accept Islam from them was the year 12. With the Bayat al-Aqaba al-Ula, okay, and so it is the wisdom of Allah Rabbil Alameen Subhanahu wa Taala, who wished for the people of Mecca to be the first to know about Islam, but not all of them accepted, although they were the first in the human history to know about Islam, the first to face Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but some of them faced him with the enmity and were rebellious and others faced him with the support and giving the allegiance and being the pillar of Islam, like Bilal, the pillar, and Amr ibn Hisham Abu Jahl, the enemy. And so the issue of the when did you knew about Islam matters. It is the issue of when did you react positively to Islam, and what did you do? And how much did you dedicate from the resources that Allah gave you to Islam? And what's the percentage, what is the priority in Islam in your list of priorities? Is it the first, second, third, fourth, or it's not even in my list? And for Mu'ad radiallahu anhu arda and many of them and the people of Medina who supported Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Islam was the first and the top of their priorities. So they deserve to be acknowledged and praised in the Quran, Surah Al-Hashr, وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَا يَجِدُونَ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ حَاجَةً مِمَّا أُوتُوا وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even purified them and told us that they were deprived or they were clean off shuh al-nafs, the miserness. This is the people of Medina. Huh? So it's not the issue of that Mu'az cannot be blamed why he missed 13 years of Islam, but he was praised for what he did after that. And he died in the 18th of the Hijrah, so 18 years, and you can add few months before it, 18 years something, which were full of actions for Mu'ad radiallahu anhu arda. And although he was a young man, 18 years old, but he did for Islam a lot. And another note, which I would like actually to put some emphasis on before going with the incident of Mu'ad, in the life of Mu'ad, there are a lot of lessons for everyone, in every time, for every community. In our community, local community, in the community, in the states, where you can find everywhere, in the Muslim ummah, where you can find the diversity of the age. We need to be as inclusive as the generation of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and Mu'adh beside him, and Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم tell Mu'adh, إني أحبك يا Mu'adh, as we said last time. And Umar رجل عنه أرضاء, he said that لولا Mu'adh لهلك عمر. Mu'adh is my savior, because he used to consult with Mu'adh a lot when Umar was the Khalifa. To consult with Mu'adh, because Mu'adh was a knowledgeable young man with the knowledge, consult with him on the issues of fiqh, the issue of the wisdom as well. So, and to the extent that Umar said, you are my savior. Weren't you beside me, I would have been ruined by judgments that I would have taken, which are not matching the correct judgment of Allah, the Sharia, or the best of the wise judgments. So it is the very inclusive society where the age is not an issue. It's not an issue, it should not be an issue. That to the extent that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is entrusting Mus'ab radiallahu anhu arda to be the first ambassador for the Medina. Mus'ab, we spoke about that when we spoke about Mus'ab few months last month. And when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent his envoy, his ambassador, his messenger to teach the people of Medina to be the only voice of Islam, the only teacher of Islam in Medina, which is 500 kilometers away from Mecca, which is not easy to walk it or to travel it. It is, they used to travel, but it's not easy. Whenever Mus'ab would have a question to ask about Islam while the people are asking him, so he would travel 500 back and forth. No, he should be a learned man that is able to be the best voice of Islam. Go, Mus'ab, you are my messenger. Mus'ab, the young man. So it's not an issue of age. Don't look down at yourself. If you are a youth, this is an advantage that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you. So stand up for it and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you are a young man who knows what's the wisdom of his life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him, eliminated that in his heart to know that I am a Muslim and I have a vision for my life, so I need to stand for it. This is a lesson for the youth, a lesson for the community leaders. You should give them the chance and give them the leverage and the full available chance to be the leaders for the future. Give them the training, give them the position. Not just the training and keep them on the side. The position to be leaders, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam give Mu'adh and the Mus'ab and Abdullah ibn Abbas beside him. Abdullah ibn Abbas, the young, even he was younger than Mu'adh, but he used to be beside Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the gathering of the elders of the Sahaba, the well-respected people of the Sahaba. So the community used to be inclusive, and the leadership of the community represented in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and after that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Umar radiallahu anhu, and all the major of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum jami'an, they used to give this chance to recruit, to develop, to produce leaders for the future. And this is why someone like Mu'adh radiallahu anhu found himself in the area of the scholarship training and to have a remarkable position at the scholar of the Sahaba, to the extent that Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we said last time, called him Imam al-Ulama. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him this, and we mentioned some of the titles from Mu'adh last time. يُؤْتَى يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ بِالْعُلَمَاءِ وَمُعَاذٌ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ بِرَتْوَةٍ. With the distance that this and that when you throw a pebble, the distance that will be between when you throw it, this is the position of Mu'adh at the Imam, the leader of ulama, Yawm al-Qiyamah. And he was at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. Mu'adh radiallahu anhu arda was 28 years old. And even if we assume that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said it in the last day of his life, which was, but in the 28, and to give him this label Imam al-Ulama, who gave it to him? Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the lesson for the youth and for the leaders in the community, that we need to have a cohesive community. And for the youth among us who are still, mashallah, and aspiring for the future and the future is still in front of them. Allah subhanahu knows best. Inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the power and the age and the opportunity to use it to the best. Don't look down at what you have, and assume the leadership and stand for it and play it as Abdullah ibn Abbas did it. And we spoke about Abdullah radiallahu anhu. He was one of the first compilers of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he commissioned himself to compile the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he did it radiallahu anhu arda. Coming back to Mu'ad radiallahu anhu arda, and last time we spoke about his life and how the special relationship between him and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam raised him by himself alayhi salatu wasalam, fixing his mistakes. And we mentioned the issue of the long prayer he used to pray with the people. He sallallahu alaihi wasalam tamed him. Fattanun anta Mu'ad, are you courage Mu'ad, be easy with the people, at the same time praising him, giving him all of these great labels. Mu'ad Imam al-Ulama, ni'mal rajul Mu'ad, very clear acknowledgement from Rasulullah and the praising words from Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ni'ma ar-rajul Abu Bakr, ni'ma ar-rajul Umar, ni'ma Umar, ni'ma ar-rajul Uthman, ni'ma ar-rajul Mu'ad ibn Jabal, ni'ma ar-rajul Mu'ad ibn Jamuh, ni'ma ar-rajul Abdullah Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam listed few names, and among them Mu'ad ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu, the young adult radiyallahu anhu arda. So it is a special position. Let's move with Mu'ad radiyallahu anhu arda, and this, today I will speak about few points of the characteristics of the personality of Mu'ad. The first one, which is his position among the Sahaba. I speak about his position among the Sahaba, speak about his generosity, how generous he was radiyallahu anhu arda, and how entrusted he was radiyallahu anhu arda, and how good God fearing he was radiyallahu anhu arda, and how his purity and his indifference to the dunya. And we will come to his death radiyallahu anhu arda, his death moment, which is very much touching moment. His position among the Sahaba, we mentioned how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him a special position. Umar radiallahu anhu arda, we mentioned some of the words of Umar as well, how he used to consult with Mu'ad radiallahu anhu arda a lot. And he radiallahu anhu arda mentioned the word, but I will repeat it again. Umar, when he came to die, and he asked him to appoint, to suggest a name or few names for them to choose from as his successor, to succeed Umar, to lead, to be the next Khalifa. And he mentioned some names, and he said, if Mu'az is alive, Mu'az died before Umar died, radiallahu anhu arda. If Mu'az was alive, I would have appointed him or give him or suggest him for you. So, and I will feel very much comfortable if I will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and will ask, because it is a responsibility, okay? And will ask me, whom did you appoint or suggest after you to lead the Ummah of Muhammad? I would have said, these are the words of Umar, I would have said that I suggested Mu'az ibn Jabal for them, because I heard your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, يُؤْتَى مُعَادٌ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ بَيْنَ الْعُلَمَاءِ إِمَامٌ لِلْعُلَمَاءِ بِرَطْوَةِ. I heard your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and I will mention that very comfortably to Allah as and my argument to defend my decision to give him the leadership after me, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the Mu'ad will come, the scholars will come yawm al-qiyamah before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Mu'ad is advancing them, is leading them with a distance. So I have a legitimate reason to give him, to appoint him. So Umar radiallahu anhu was very, very much comfortable with Mu'ad. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu arda make a resemblance and the connection between Mu'ad and Ibrahim al-Khalil. Inna Ibrahim kana ummatan qanitan lillahi hanifan walam yakun min al-mushrikeen. Umma. And one time Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, Mu'ad ummatan qanitun lillahi hanifan. They said, do you mean Ibrahim? He said, no, I meant Mu'ad. فَإِنَّ الْأُمَّةَ مُعَلِّمُ النَّاسِ الْخَيْرِ وَالْقَارِتُ مُطِيعَ. The Ummah, which Allah meant in the Quran, the one who is teaching people the goodness, because when you teach someone the goodness, he will teach others, so we are creating Ummah of learned people. Mu'ad used to teach people the goodness. Qanit, the one who is obedient to Allah, and Mu'ad is the one who is obedient to Allah. So وكنا نشبه as the words of ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه وارضاه لقد كنا نشبه معاذا بإبراهيم عليه الصلاة والسلام رجل. And by the way, عبد الله بن مسعود, we know that he's a very learned man. He was one of the فقهاء of the صحابة رضي الله عليهم. So when عبد الله بن مسعود made this testimony for معاذ, it is valuable. It means a lot for معاذ to be in this position. There are other two testimonies actually for معاذ. Two of the عائذ بن عبد الله رضي الله عنه وارضاه, he did not meet معاذ before. He said one time I went stepped in the masjid and I found a lot of صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and at the time of Umar, and I found a lot of them, more than 30 of them are saying the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallam said this and that and that and that, groups, and I found and whenever they disagree or in any of this hadith, they used to return back to a young man who was sitting by them. He was the youngest among them. He was sitting calm and quiet, and he never speaks till they ask him to speak or to ask him about something. So he would reply them and come quiet again, and they used to take his judgment, his opinion, very calmly and very comfortably. This is Mu'adh. When I asked about him, who are you? He said, I am Mu'adh ibn Jabal رضي الله عنه وارضاه. This is among the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The learned, the Sahaba used to come to ask them in this agreement. Another occasion when he was sent to Al-Sham, and as well Abu Muslim al-Khawalani رضي الله عنه وارضاه, he said, I stepped in the Masjid of Homs, and I found in the Masjid of Homs جماعه من الكهول, a group of elderly people, and ويتوسطهم شاب براق الثنايا صامت لا يتكلم. And among them there is a young man, he smiled. براق الثنايا, it's an expression which means that he has a white teeth, but it means as well that he is smiling. When you smile, your teeth showing. براق الثنايا, it's a very bright teeth. He's smiling all the time, and he's calm, quiet, does not speak till they ask him رضي الله عنه وارضاه. And as well they used to ask him رضي الله عنه وارضاه, and after that I asked my friend, who is that? He said, هذا معاذ بن جبل رضي الله عنه وارضاه. And أبو مسلم الخراني say, فوقع حبه في قلبي رضي الله عنه وارضاه. So I loved him from his attitude, from his how respected his position رضي الله عنه وارضاه among the صحابة رضي الله عنه. عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه وارضاه said a wonderful word about معاذ, which is similar to what he said before about Khalid ibn Walid رضي الله عنه وارضاه. said عجدت النساء أن يلدن مثله. The ladies will never be able to bring someone like معاذ anymore, to bear anyone like معاذ anymore رضي الله عنه. And he said that about Khalid ibn Walid as well رضي الله عنه وارضاه. عمر أسود as well said من أراد الفقه. One time عمر raised a hilly area, and he said very made a, after he made a khutbah, and he said من أراد الفقه فليأتي معاذ بن جبل. Whoever wants anything related to the fiqh, let him to go to معاذ بن جبل. I give معاذ بن جبل the latitude and the permission to make the fiqh. And again عمر رضي الله عنه وارضاه used to be one of the فقهاء of the صحابة. We mentioned the six people, the four people whom Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, six people whom Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave a permission to make fatwa in his life, during his life radhiyallahu anhu sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of them was Mu'adh ibn Jabal and Umar ibn Khattab radhiyallahu anhu arda. So Mu'adh was very distinguished. Let's move to how entrusted he was, entrusted between in the among the sahaba radhiyallahu anhu arda. And we mentioned Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam after fath Makkah in the 10th year of the in the 8th year of the Hijra, and he left with the people of Mecca, two people, one of them to pray for them as the Imam, Attab ibn Usayd رضي الله عنه وارضاه, and Mu'adh ibn Jabal يقرئهم ويعلمهم. It's an acknowledgement from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم with the leadership of Attab to lead the Salah, and the scholarship of Mu'adh to teach the people of Mecca who just became Muslims behind, and he left them رضي الله عنه وارضاه in Mecca till In the year after, which was Tabuk, in the year after, 9th of the Hijrah, after Tabuk, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him to Al-Yaman to teach the people of Yemen Al-Islam as well. And he sent him by himself. And we mentioned that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tested him and checked it, and he taught him how to deal with the people of the book of Yemen. They were, used to be Christians, and he taught and after that he checked him, tested him how to make your judgment, and after that made dua to him, Rajallahu arda Muad, Rajallahu arda, and he asked him he asked Allah Subhanahu wa Taala for Muad to be supported from his before his hands and behind him, Rajallahu anhu arda. This is at the time of Abu Bakr, not just Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Bakr as well. After Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, Mu'adh came back to Medina, and Abu Bakr returned him back to Al-Yaman. Continue your commissionship. Continue your job. And Abu Bakr entrusted him on the people of Medina Yemen as well. At the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, Umar commissioned him twice. One time he commissioned him as a commissioner, as to the one who was his liaison to the people of Bani Kilab, to distribute the stipends for the for this this tribe. So he entrusted him on the money, and I will mention a wonderful incident for the Mu'adh and the how God fearing he was in relationship to the money. And Umar, you know, Umar is not an easy man. Umar is very checking on the people whom he assigns, and Umar, he has a lot of checkpoints and follow up for any kind of assignment he's giving. For him to send someone to distribute money and to be entrusted in money, it means that this one has to be very much highly qualified for that, very much entrusted. He sent Mu'adh, Rajal Anharda, to the people of Bani Kilab, Rajal Anharda, to distribute their stipends and salaries, and as well to take this zakah from their rich people and distribute it on their poor people. And Umar, Rajal Anharda, let me mention it in the same context. When he sent him, he came back, Mu'adh, after he finished his job. And he came back with just, all what he came with is just the saddle he left with, which is which he used to sit on his mount. Okay? Hilsi, the saddle that you spread on your mount, that you can sit on it, okay? On your camel or whatever. He came exactly as he left, Rajal Anharda. And when he approached his wife at home, she said, okay, Where are the gifts? He said, I don't have any gifts with me. He said, all the commissioners that are sent to do something, they return with gifts to their families. And he said, I used to have a supervisor with me. She said, oh, supervisor, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entrusted you, and Abu Bakr entrusted you, and now Umar is sending supervisor with you. How comes? And it spread around with the wives of Umar. And Umar heard it, and he said, he called upon Mu'adh, and he said, did I send a supervisor with you? He said, no, he did not send a supervisor with me, but I have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as my supervisor. And believe me, Umar, I did not find any excuse for her. She was asking for a gift, and I don't have anything to give her, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my supervisor. And Umar radiallahu anhu was very much pleased with what Mu'adh did, meaning that he did not take any of the trusts, and with the wisdom of Mu'adh as well for how to deal in this. And he said, he gave him a gift and said, go and give it to her, let her to be pleased, and bring the pleasure to her, Rajal Anhu Arda. So the point of how he trustworthy he was, Rajal Anhu Arda, and how Amin entrusted he was, an honest Rajal Anhu Arda. Umar as well entrusted him after that, which was towards the end of the life of Mu'adh radiallahu anhu arda, another job, when he sent him to Asham. He sent him to Asham for two jobs. The first job, which is to teach the people of Sham. And he sent three actually to do this job. When the people of Sham came to Umar radiallahu anhu arda and told him that the people of Sham, mashallah, Islam is spread a lot in Asham, which is currently Syria, Lebanon, Palestine, and the Jordan, this area. I said, Islam spread a lot, and we need someone. Send us someone or group people to teach us Islam. And the masajid are full. And Umar sent three. He sent Ubadah ibn Samit, and Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, and Mu'adh ibn Jabal. And Umar told them, go to Hims first. Go to Hims first, the three of you. If he found the situation that there is a need for the three of you to stay in the people of Hims, stay. But if you did not find, one of you should leave to Damascus. And the third one, if you found a need, there is no need in Damascus. So one of you will stay, and the other two will go to Damascus. If there is no need in Damascus, I need someone for you to go to Palestine, to Al-Quds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala free the three of them. Hims, Damascus, and Al-Quds. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this night, while we are gathered here for nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while the malaika are around us, while Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is witnessing us today, to alleviate the hardship from the people of Hams, the people of Damascus, the people of Syria, the people of Palestine. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it an easy on them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to stop any aggression against them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take care of them and to alleviate their hardship, to feed them and to shelter them and to give them the security. Allahumma ameen, Allahumma ameen, Allahumma ameen. So it was actually that Ubad ibn Samit radiallahu anhu stayed in Hims, and Abu al-Ansari moved to Damascus, and Mu'ad radiallahu anhu went to Palestine. Towards the end of life, the life of Mu'ad, I did not come back. We did not approach his end of his life, but I will finish it while talking about how was he entrusted. And Umar entrusted him to the last moment of his life. When Abu Ubaid ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu anhu passed away in the plague, the infectious disease of Amwas, Ta'un Amwas, which took place in the 18th year of the Hijrah, and it was an infectious disease that spread in Asham, and Abu Ubaid ibn al-Jarrah was the leader of Asham. After Umar radiallahu anhu dismissed Khalid, we spoke about Khalid before, from the leader, general leadership, commandship of the troops of the army of the Muslims in Asham, he appointed Abu Ubaidah. Then Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu was affected by the plague of Amwas and he died. And Umar radiallahu anhu appointed Mu'adh radiallahu anhu out of his trust to Mu'adh, not just as a learned man, knowledgeable, but as well as a leader. His leadership skills is give him the ability to unite the forces and to lead the Muslims in this area. And they are still facing the issue of the Romans and so he's able, Rajal Anharda, as a leader to stand for it, to give it, which gives you an aspect of the personality of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Rajal Anharda. All of these assignments after assignment, which means that he was a well-respected, well-known man in among the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu arda, and as well, when we say that Umar appoints him, as I said, it means that he is fit for it. Umar will never appoint someone except he is fit for it. Let's move to some other features of the personality of Mu'adh. I will mention two in one, which is the first one, which is how generous he was, and as well, how pure he was, which will be complemented by Allah Azza wa Jal, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well is generous and taking care of us. The issue is, Mu'adh radiallahu anhu arda, he was very generous. And they said, no one asked him for anything, but he used to give. He never held anything with him. And if you will come to ask him something, he used to give to the extent that he accumulated debt. Mu'adh accumulated a lot of debt during the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His debtors came chasing him, and some of them were Jewish from the people of Medina. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mediated for him, asking his debtors either to drop some of the debt or to table it. They refused. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him to bring all what he has, all the assets, and he sallallahu alaihi wasallam sold them and paid back his debt, radiallahu anhu arda. So he became bankrupt, radiallahu anhu arda. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to fix it, to help him. So he sent him, when the people of Yemen asked for someone to teach him, he sent him to Yemen. He is qualified for the job as a teacher, as a faqih, and as a judge, at the same time to appoint him as an employee for the Muslims. So he stayed at the time in Yemen during the last year of the life of Rasulullah and another part of the Abu Bakr Rajal Anhu Arda. And during the life of Abu Bakr, this is the issue of the generosity, okay? And he was very generous. It will come now the issue of the purity of Mu'adh. During the time of Abu Bakr, while he is still in Yemen, It came to the attention of Umar that Mu'adh became rich during the time of Abu Bakr. And when Mu'adh came to Al-Madinah in a visit, Umar met him and he said, Mu'adh, I know that you became rich. I'm not questioning where did you get this money from. But my advice to you, half it into two halves. Divide it into two halves. And give one of the halves for the Baytul Muslimin. This is more purifying for you, cleansing for you. By that, you will make sure that nothing of this money is infected by any kind of shubha. Okay? And you'll be cleared completely. He said, no, I'm sure that this money, alhamdulillah, is for halal. I will not do it. Umar left him. It was an advice. Next day, and Umar spoke to Abu Bakr, Abu Bakr said, no, I will not take any money from him. He knows what he, how did he earn it, and I trust him. So I will not take any money from him. Next day, Mu'adh came after the Fajr and he hugged Umar while weeping. And he hugged Umar and said, Umar, I saw a dream that I was walking in a lake and a pond and about to drown. I'm about to drown and you came and you rescued me. You came and you rescued me from that. And I'm willing to give up half of my money. And Jazakallah khayra for your advice. They went to Abu Bakr and they, Mu'adh presented it. Umar did not, it's just Umar gave the advice and did not get into it. Mu'adh presented it to Abu Bakr and Abu Bakr said, no, this is your money. May Allah place you in your money. So long as you are a learned man and we entrust you. And he did not take it. And Umar after that met Mu'adh and they say, Al-ana halla wa taba. Now you did your part. Al-ana, this is now halal and tayyib. Now your money is pure. You did your part and take it and enjoy it. This is can give you how pure and how God-fearing he was, radiallahu anhu arda, and he was ready to clear up his... I hope that every one of us will have this kind of God-fear in the heart. And the pure that if you know that something is haram, avoid it. And even كان صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتركون تسعة أعشار الحلال مخافة الوقوع في الحرام. This is the attitude of the صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. They used to leave 90% of the halal, fearing that the rest of the 10% might have some mixed with something haram, so I will avoid it. Let's go with Mu'adh radiallahu anhu arda to see how he was indifferent to the dunya. Radiallahu anhu arda never paid about anything in the dunya. One time during the time of Umar radiallahu anhu arda, he sent this is one of the checks and balances that Umar used to give to his appointees. At the time of Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah radiallahu anhu arda, Umar sent one of his employees with the 400 dinars, and he told him, go and give it to Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah in Al-Sham, and they wait for him to see how he will deal with it. Wait for him. I come back to me, tell me. And he said, when he went to Abu Ubaidah and gave him, this is a gift from the Khalifa to Abu Ubaidah, and Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu arda started distributing the 400 dinars right away. This is 5, this is 7, go. And his servants go to this with that, give this with that, and he finished everything. And the messenger of Umar radiallahu anhu witnessed all of that. And he came to Umar and he told him what happened. And when Mu'adh radiallahu anhu arda was appointed in the same place of Abu Ubaidah, he did the same with Mu'adh. And he as well, he distributed them to the extent that his wife told him that, did you leave anything for us? The 400 dinars were in this container. Did you leave? He said, wallahi, I just have 2 of them left. You can take them. It's a personal money. It's a personal money. It's not a money that you need to spend on the city. No, it's a personal money. But this is how they were indifferent to the dunya. When the man came back to Umar and he told him the same story, he said, radiallahu anhu arda, he said, innahum ikhwatun ba'duhum min ba'd. This is the same attitude of Abu Ubaidah, the same attitude of Mu'adh. They are brothers. They are the production of the same school of Muhammad. عليه الصلاة والسلام صلى الله عليه وسلم. معاذ رضي الله عنه was they said that he was very much just and he has 2 wives. رضي الله عنه. They said that if this is the night or the day of one of these wives, wife A, he never drinks in the house of wife B. completely give the full attention, this is your right. So he never even drank water from the other house or even speak to the other wife. And when both of them died during the plague where Mu'adh died, his two wives died before him from the same infectious disease, the two wives. And when he came to get them in the grave, رجل عنه أرضاه, he made a toss between them, whom should I get first? Both of them died at the same time, to the extent that he was just between them to the last, till the moment of their death. Whom should I give bury first? So he made a toss between them. How just he was, رجل عنه أرضاه. The last point, which is the point of the death of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, رجل عنه أرضاه, we said that it was in the 18th year of the Hijrah, when he was around 38 and other narrations 37. He was the leader or the governor of Asham, and during the Ta'un Amwas, of the plague of Amwas in Asham, and he was affected by this Ta'un, the infectious disease, رجل عنه أرضاه. Before him, his two wives died and his sons died, رجل عنه أرضاه, and he came to die, رجل عنه أرضاه. In the night, he said the wonderful words that I would like to exchange with you. The last few words he said, رجل عنه أرضاه. And the night when they came to him while he was in his deathbed, and one of his friends was weeping and crying, and he said that I'm crying because of the knowledge that we will miss after you. He used to be our, not just our leader, our murabbi, our big brother. You are young, but you are our spiritual, educational, our scholar. And he said, رجل عنه أرضاه, till the last moment of his life, he knows his job, and he never leaves his people without a guidance. فَالْتَمِسُ الْعِلْمَ عِنْدَ أَرْبَعَةٍ عِنْدَ عُمَيْمِرْ أَبِي الدَّرْدَاءِ وعند سلمان الفارسي وعند عبد الله بن مسعود وعند عبد الله بن سلام. Seek the knowledge in these four people, because these four people are very knowledgeable people. And the last night of his life, he used to ask people, are we in the morning yet? He said, no, not yet. And a while, after a while, is it the morning yet? No, it's not yet. Until the morning came and he came, he said, أعوذ بالله من ليلة صباحها إلى النار. أعوذ بالله من ليلة صباحها إلى النار. I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the night that the morning of it will be to the hellfire. And he said, listen to this dua, Allahumma inni kuntu akhafuka wa ana al-yawma arjuk. Allahumma inni kuntu akhafuka, all my life I used to fear you, wa ana al-yawma arjuk. Today I'm hoping in your mercy, and I'm full of hope in your generous mercy. Allahumma innaka ta'lamu أني ما أحببت البقاء في الدنيا ولا طول البقاء, ما أحببت الدنيا ولا طول البقاء فيها لكري الأنهار ولا لغرس الأشجار, ولكن لضمأ الهواجر ومكابدة الساعات ومزاحمة العلماء بالركب في حلق الذكر. والله, you know that, and he started talking about what he used to do in his life, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what he do. It's a sunnah. It's a good approved reason to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with something good that you did, to make tawassul to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is one of the forms of the approved tawassul, to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with something that you did. And the people of the cave, the four people of the cave, the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us about, and they started asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tawassul Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with what he did. Mu'adh radiallahu anhu said, Ya Allah, you know that I lived all of my life, never asked for long life, to enjoy the rivers of the life, or to the gardens of the life, but you know that I used to live my life with the full love for dhama al-hawajir, for the long fasting days, hot days that I used to do, ومكابدت الساعات, and the long standing in night, and prayers at night, and the competition with the scholars in the halaq al-dhikr, and seeking the knowledge, to compete with others seeking the knowledge. Oh Allah, ask me, oh Allah, I ask you for your forgiveness with what I did. رضي الله عنه وارضاه. And after that, رضي الله عنه وارضاه, he passed away while he was 38 years old. Again, this is Mu'adh ibn Jabal, the learned Imam al-Ulama, رضي الله عنه وارضاه. And we said, take your position as a young man and a young woman in your community, in your and be the leader in it. And for the elders, please give them the chance. Planned action, not haphazard action. Planned action to have the tens of the young men and women around us in the community to be leaders by action, by plan. قولوا قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. Next week inshallah we'll start the our journey with أم المؤمنين أم سلمة, the fourth of the wives of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. We'll start talking about أم سلمة رضي الله عنها وأرضاها next week inshallah. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك, نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, نستغفرك ونتوب.